Welcome to the video lecture of Food Process Technology. I'm Dr. Ramya, Associate Professor, Department of Industrial Biotechnology. Today's topic is thermal processing. Heat treatment remains one of the most important methods used in food processing, not only because of the desirable effects on eating quality, that is, many foods are consumed in a cooked form, and process such as baking produce flavors that cannot be created by some other means. So, but also because of the preservative effect on foods by the destruction of enzymes, microorganisms, insects and parasites. So the main advantages of heat processing are relatively simple control of processing conditions capable to produce shelf-stable foods that do not require refrigeration. The next is about destruction of anti-nutritional factors. For example, we can tell like trypsin inhibitor in some legumes. And then the last we can say is about the improvement in the availability of some nutrients. For example, improved digestibility of proteins, gelatinization of starches and release of bound niacin. So heat also alters or destroys the components of food that are responsible for their individual flavor, color, taste or texture, and as a result they are perceived to have a low quality and of lower value. So here, the heat processing using steam or water is the first session that comes under general thermal processing. So what are the heat processing that were used like pasteurization, sterilization, canning, and blanching. So we'll see individual heat processing using steam or water in the upcoming slides. First, we will see about pasteurization. So the purpose of pasteurization is the thermal pasteurization. It is a relatively mild heat treatment given to foods with the purpose of destroying selected vegetative species of microorganisms, such as many pathogens that cause foodborne illness, as well as to accomplish inactivation of enzymes. Pasteurization is a relatively mild heat treatment in which food is heated to below 100 degrees centigrade. In low acid foods, that is pH of greater than 4.5, for example, we can take milk. It is used to minimize possible health hazards from pathogenic microorganisms and to extend the shelf life of foods for several days. In acidic foods, that is pH less than 4.5, for example, bottled fruit, it is used to extend the shelf life for several months by destruction of spoilage microorganisms like yeast, molds, and all. So in both type of food, minimal changes that are caused to sensory characteristics or nutritive value. So processing containers of food, either which have a naturally low pH, as like of fruits, or in which the pH is artificially lowered, for example, pickles, is similar to canning. So this is often termed pasteurization to indicate the mild heat treatment employed. The sensible heat required to raise the temperature of a liquid during pasteurization is found using the formula Q is equal to mc theta E minus theta B. So Q is the specific rate of heat transfer, M is the mass flow rate, C is the specific heat capacity, and theta A minus theta B is the temperature change. So the extent of the heat treatment required to stabilize a food is determined by D value. This has been discussed in the earlier session. For most heat resistant enzymes or microorganisms, for example, milk pasteurization is based on D value. And the liquid whole egg is treated to produce the reduction in number of the bacterial strain. So as flavors, colors, and vitamins are also that are characterized by D values. The pasteurization conditions, these can be optimized for retention of nutritional and sensory quality by the use of certain temperature conditions that have been used for pasteurization, like for example, high temperature, short time condition. So for example, in milk processing, the other method, that is low temperature, longer time, that could be called as LTLT process, that we're operating at 63 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes, that is the holding process, that causes greater change to flavor and a slightly greater loss of vitamins than HTST, that is high temperature, short time processing. That is at 71.8 degrees centigrade for 15 seconds. And it is less often used also. So higher temperature and shorter time, that is, for example, 88 degrees centigrade for 1 second, 94 degrees centigrade for 0.1 second, or like 100 degrees centigrade for 0.01 second for milk. They are described as higher heat, shorter time processing, or flash pasteurization. Next, we'll see about the equipment of pasteurization. That is, first is the pasteurization of packaged foods. That we'll see here, that some liquid foods, for example, we can take an example for fruit juices or beers that are pasteurized after filling into containers. So hot water is normally used if the food is packed in glass to reduce the risk of thermal shock to the container. Maximum temperature differences between the container and the water are 20 degrees centigrade for heating and 10 degrees centigrade for cooling. So metal or plastic containers are processed using steam air mixtures or hot water, as there is a little risk of thermal shock. So in all the cases, the food is cooled to approximately 40 degrees centigrade to evaporate surface water and therefore to minimize external corrosion to the container or cap and to accelerate setting of label adhesives. Hot water pasteurizers may be batch or it can be a continuous in operation. So in batch equipment, it consists of a water bath in which it has been packaged, foods are heated to preset temperatures and held for the required length of time. Cold water is then pumped into cool the product. A continuous version consists of a long narrow trough fitted with a conveyor belt to carry containers through heating and cooling stages. So another design consists of a tunnel that are divided into number of heating zones. So atomized water sprays, that is fine, very fine water sprays, heat the containers as they pass through each zone on a conveyor to give incremental rise in temperature until pasteurization is achieved. So water sprays then cool the containers as they continue through the tunnel. Savings in energy and water consumptions, they are achieved by recirculation of water between preheat sprays, where it is cooled by incoming food, and cooling zones, where it is heated by hot products. So steam tunnels have the advantage of faster heating that gives shorter residence time and smaller equipment. Temperatures in the heating zones are gradually increased by reducing the amount of air in the steam air mixtures. And cooling takes place using fine sprays of water or by immersion in a water bath. So in this figure, time temperature relationships for pasteurization has been given in the first one. The hatched area shows the range of times and temperatures used in commercial milk pasteurization. The next is about the pasteurization of unpackaged liquids. So here the plate heat exchanger can be seen here. So here the large scale pasteurization of low viscous liquids, for example, milk, milk products, fruit juices, they were usually employed what this plate heat exchangers. So some products are require de-aeration to prevent oxidative changes during storage. They are sprayed into a vacuum chamber and dissolved air is removed by vacuum pump before pasteurization. So here it can, this is the plate heat exchanger that consists of a series of thin vertical stainless steel plates that were held tightly in a metal frame. So the plates form parallel channels and liquid food and heating media, that is hot water or steam. They are pumped through alternate channels, usually in a counter current flow pattern. So each plate is fitted with synthetic rubber gasket to produce a watertight seal and to prevent mixing of the product and the heating and cooling media. So the advantages of heat exchangers over in bottle processing, they include more uniform heat treatment, then simpler equipment and lower maintenance cost, then lower space requirements and labor cost, greater flexibility for different products, and greater control over pasteurization conditions. The pasteurized foods, they are immediately filled into bottles and sealed to prevent recontamination. The significant level of spoilage and risk from pathogens can arise from post-pasteurization contamination, particularly when foods, for example, milk, are not reheated before consumption. And great care with cleaning and hygiene is therefore very necessary. The products should then be stored at refrigerated temperature until consumption. So here, effect on foods, we'll see. The pasteurization we have already discussed, like it is a mild heat treatment, and even when combined with the other unit operations, there are only minor changes to the nutritional and sensory characteristics of most foods. However, the shelf life of pasteurized food is usually only extended by a few days or weeks, compared with many months with a more severe heat sterilization. First, we'll see about color, flavor, and aroma. In fruit juices, the main cause of color deterioration is enzymic browning by polyphenol oxidase. So this is promoted by the presence of oxygen, and fruit juices are therefore routinely de-aerated prior to pasteurization. The difference between the whiteness of raw milk and that of pasteurized milk is due to homogenization, and pasteurization alone has no measurable effects. Other pigments in plant and animal compounds are also mostly unaffected by pasteurization. A small loss of volatile aroma compounds during pasteurization of juices cause a reduction in quality and may also they unmask other cooked flavors. So loss of volatiles from raw milk removes a hay-like aroma and produces a blander product. So the next is about vitamin loss. So in fruit juices, loss of vitamin C and carotene are minimized by deaeration. Changes to milk are confined to a minimum of 5% loss of serum proteins and small changes to the vitamin content. And changes to nutritional quality during storage of pasteurized milk are that could also be observed. Sterilization implies the destruction of all viable microorganisms. The term is commonly used in reference to the food canning process that will be discussed in the upcoming slides, because canned foods are shelf stable and seem never to experience microbial spoilage. So these foods are far from being sterile in the medical sense of the word. So the success of the canning process that does not lie in destroying all viable microorganisms, but in the fact that together with food chemistry and microenvironment within the container, that is partial vacuum and storage temperature less than that required for the growth of thermophilic bacteria, the given thermal process prevents the growth of microorganisms of spoilage causing any health concern. So the determining the time and temperature of a thermal sterilization process takes into account the thermal inactivation kinetics, that is heat resistance of the target microorganisms, as well as its sensitivity to oxygen, pH and temperature. The absence of oxygen in the container prevents the growth of aerobic microorganisms, and if the storage temperature is kept below 25 degrees centigrade, high heat resistant spore forming thermophilic bacteria that pose very little or no problem. From the health perspective, the microorganism of greatest concern in low acid foods with pH greater than 4.5, for example, about Clostridium botulinum bacteria. So this is a heat resistant anaerobic bacteria. So if it survives processing, it can potentially grow and produce a deadly toxin, that is botulism, in a canned food. And Clostridium botulinum is a spore forming bacteria, and like most spore forming bacteria, cannot grow at pH less than 4.5. That is acid and acidified foods. So the spore forming bacteria that can grow in low acid foods are far more heat resistant, and they require temperature well above the atmospheric boiling point of water for thermal inactivation. So therefore low acid foods, they must be processed with equipment systems that operate under pressure, such as pasteurized retorts or autoclaves used in canning for in-container sterilization, or ultra-high temperature processing of liquid products in heat exchanger systems through which the product flows under pressure controlled by a back pressure valve. So a preferred alternative to heat exchanger systems for ultra-high temperature processing is the use of steam injection or steam infusion. So in these systems, pressurized live stream of steam is being injected directly into liquid product just prior to entering the cold tube. So this causes the temperature of the resulting mixture of steam condensate and liquid product to rise instantaneously to the sterilizing temperature. Steam infusion is accomplished when the product enters a pasteurized steam chamber prior to entering the whole tube. That could be seen in the figure. So ultra-high temperature process is used to produce long shelf life refrigerated low acid liquid products such as ultra-high temperature milk or cream. Shelf stable low acid liquid products require aseptic processing in which the cool ultra-high temperature sterilized product is filled into sterile containers within a sterile atmosphere to avoid post-process contamination from airborne microorganisms. Different types of heat exchanger are represented in the figures, like plate heat exchanger and schematic of representation of tubular heat exchangers, etc. You can see here. Steam infusion heat exchanger is illustrated here in the figure. The steam infusion is accomplished when the product enters a pressurized steam chamber prior to entering the whole tube. Coming to effect on foods, the purpose of heat sterilization is to extend the shelf life of foods for storage at ambient temperatures while minimizing the changes in nutritional value and eating quality. So the first is about the color. The time temperature combination used in canning have a substantial effect on most naturally occurring pigments in foods. For example, in meats, the red oxymyoglobin pigment is converted to brown metmyoglobin, and purplish myoglobin is converted to red-brown myohemochromogen. So Maillard browning and caramelization also contribute to the color of sterilized meats. So this is an acceptable change in cooked meats. So in fruits and vegetables, chlorophyll is converted to phytophytin. Carotenoids are isomerized from 5-6 epoxides to less intensely colored 5-8 epoxides. And anthocyanins, they are degraded to brown pigments. So this loss of color is often corrected using permitted synthetic colors. So discoloration of canned foods during storage occurs. For example, when iron or tin reacts with anthocyanins to form a purple pigment, or when colorless leucoanthocyanins form pink anthocyanin complex in some varieties of pears and quinces. So in sterilized milk, slight color changes are due to caramelization, Maillard browning, and changes in the reflectivity of casein micellar. So next about flavor and aroma. In canned meats, there are complex changes, for example, pyrolysis, deamination, and decarboxylation of amino acids, degradation, then caramelization of carbohydrates to furfural and hydroxymethyl furfural, and oxidation and decarboxylation of lipids. So the interactions between these compounds, they produce more than 600 flavor compounds in some 9 to 10 chemical classes. In fruits and vegetables, changes are due to complex reactions which involve the degradation, recombination, and volatilization of aldehydes, ketones, sugars, lactose, amino acids, and organic acids. In milk, the development of a cooked flavor is due to denaturation of whey protein to form hydrogen sulfide and formation of lactones and methyl ketones from lipids. So the next is about texture or viscosity. So in canned meats, changes in texture are caused by coagulation and the loss of water holding capacity of proteins that reduce shrinkage and stiffening of muscle tissues. Softening is caused by hydrolysis of collagen, solubilization of the resulting gelatin, and melting and dispersion of fats through products. So the polyphosphates are added to some products to bind water. This increases the tenderness of the product and reduce the shrinkage. When considering about fruits and vegetables, softening is caused by hydrolysis of pectin materials, gelatinization of starches, and partial solubilization of hemicelluloses combined with loss of cell turgor. Calcium salts may be added to blanched water or to brine or syrup to form insoluble calcium pectate and thus to increase the firmness of the canned product. So, like, different salts are needed for different types of fruit. Depending upon the type they are, we are using. So small changes in the viscosity of milk are caused by modification of K casein, leading to the increased sensitivity to calcium precipitation and coagulation. Then next is about the nutritional value. So this causes the hydrolysis of carbohydrates and lipids, but the nutrients remain available and the nutritional value of food is not affected. So proteins are coagulated and in canned milk, meat, loss of amino acids about 10 to 20%. So reduction in lysine content are proportional to the severity of heating, but rarely exceed 25%. So there are large variations owing to differences in the types of food, the presence of residual oxygen in the container, and methods of preparation or blanching. So in some foods, blanching will be discussed in the following slides. So in some foods, vitamins are transferred into brine or syrup, which is also consumed. So there is thus a small nutritional loss. And coming to canning, food canning is most often referred to as thermal processing within the food industry. So thermal processing that consists of heating food containers in pressurized retorts, that is autoclaves or pressure cookers, at specified temperature for prescribed length of time. So these process times are calculated on the basis of achieving sufficient bacterial inactivation, that is lethality, in each container to assure food safety to the consuming public and to ensure that the probability of spoilage will be less than some minimum. So associated with each thermal process, it is always, there is some degradation of heat sensitive vitamins and other quality factors that is undesirable. So because of these quality and safety factors, great care is taken in the calculation of process time and in the control of time and temperature during processing to avoid either under or over processing. So the methods by which these process times and temperature are calculated and the scientific principles upon which they are based can be found somewhere. We discuss the commercial retort equipment systems that are used in food canning industry to accomplish thermal processing efficiently on a production scale. So two types of systems are described here. One is batch system, batch retort system, and the other is what? Continuous retort system. So batch system, they are made up of individual batch retorts that operate intermittently. But in case of continuous systems, they are automatically fed into and out of retort systems that operate continuously. In the first figure, modern day horizontal batch retort can be seen, And the next figure, cut away view of continuous horizontal rotary cooker or sterilizer. That could be in the top, you can see that. And a schematic representation of helical path of travel through each rotary cooker could be seen in the bottom one for the second figure. The next is about the hydrostatic sterilizer. The hydrostatic sterilizer system, they are so named because steam pressure is controlled hydrostatically by the height of a leg of water. So because of the height of water leg required, these sterilizers are usually installed outdoors adjacent to canning plant. So they are made up of, they are basically made up of four chambers, a hydrostatic bring up leg, a sterilizing steam dome, a hydrostatic bring down leg, and cooling section. The principle of operation for a hydrostatic sterilizer can be explained with reference to the schematic diagram that has shown right side. So the containers are conveyed through a sterilizer on carriers connected to a continuous chain link mechanism that provides positive line speed control and thus residence time control to achieve a specified process time in steam dome. So carriers are loaded automatically from incoming can conveyors and travel to the top of the sterilizer where they enter the bring up water leg. So they travel downward through this leg as they encounter progressively hotter water. As they enter the bottom of the steam dome, the water temperature will be in equilibrium with the steam temperature at the water steam interface. So in the steam dome, the cans are exposed to specified process or retort temperature for the prescribed process time, which is controlled by carrier line speed. So when cans exit the steam dome, they again pass through the water steam interface at the bottom and travel upward through the cool down leg as they encounter progressively cooler water until they exit at the top. Cans are then sprayed. The cans are then sprayed with cooling water as the carriers travel down the outside of the sterilizer on their return to the discharge conveyor station. Next is about the blanching. So blanching serves a variety of functions, one of the main ones being to destroy enzymic activity in vegetables and some fruits prior to further processing. So it is not intended as a sole method of preservation, but as a pre-treatment, which is normally carried out between the preparation of raw materials and some of the later operations like heat sterilization, dehydration, and freezing. So blanching is also combined with peeling or cleaning of foods to achieve savings in energy consumption, space, and equipment cost. So some of the factors which influence blanching time are type of fruit or vegetable, size of the pieces of food, blanching temperature, and method of heating. Blanching reduces the number of contaminating microorganisms on the surface of food, and hence they assist in subsequent preservation operations. So this is particularly important in heat sterilization, as the time and temperature of processing are designed to achieve a specified reduction in cell number. If blanching is inadequate, a larger number of microorganisms are present initially, and this may result in a larger number of spoiled containers after processing. So the blanching are of two types of blanchers. One is a steam blancher and the other is a hot water blancher. So the steam blancher, the advantages and the limitations of steam blancher are many. So in general, this is preferred method for foods with a large area of cut surfaces, leaching losses are much smaller than those found using hot water blanchers. So in conventional steam blanching, there is often poor uniformity of heating in the multiple layers of wood. The time temperature combination required to ensure enzyme inactivation at the center of the bed results in overheating of wood at the edges and the consequent loss of texture and other sensory characteristics. Individual quick blanching, IQB, which this involves blanching in two stages. So in the first stage, the food is heated in a single layer to a sufficiently high temperature to inactivate enzyme. So in the second stage, a deep bed of food is held for sufficient time to allow the temperature at the center of each piece to increase to that needed for enzyme inactivation. The reduced heating time, for example, 25 seconds for heating and 50 seconds for holding 1 centimeter diced carrot compared with 3 minutes for conventional blanching. They results in an improvement in the efficiency of energy consumption to about 86% to 91%. So nutrient loss during steam blanching are reduced by exposing the food to warm air, that is up to 65 degrees centigrade in a short preliminary drying operation. So some of the advantages include they are faster, more uniform heating, then good mixing of the product, then substantial reduction in the volume of effluent, then shorter processing time and hence smaller loss of vitamins and other soluble heat sensitive components of food. Next, about hot water blanchers. So there are a number of different designs of blanchers, each of which holds the food in hot water at 70 to 100 degrees centigrade for a specified time and then removes it into a dewatering cooling session. So it is widely used reel blancher. Food enters a slowly rotating cylindrical mesh drum, which is partially submerged in hot water. So the food is moved through the drum by internal flights. The speed of rotation and length and control the heating time. And coming to the advantages of a conventional hot water blancher, they are lower capital cost and better energy efficiency than steam blanchers. Some of the blanchers were illustrated in this diagram. It is IQB steam blancher, blancher cooler, and counter current blancher has been given here. Then coming to effect on foods. The heat received by a food during blanching causes some changes to sensory and nutrition qualities. So however, the heat treatment is less severe than, for example, like heat sterilization, and the resulting changes in food quality are less when compared to others. So we will first see about the nutrients. Some minerals, water-soluble vitamins and other water-soluble components are lost during blanching process. So the loss of vitamins are mostly due to leaching, thermal destruction, and to a lesser extent, oxidation. The extent of vitamin loss depends on number of factors like maturity of the food and variety, then methods used in preparation of the food, particularly the extent of cutting, slicing, or dicing, then the surface area to volume ratio of the piece of food, method of blanching, then time and temperature of blanching, method of cooling, then the ratio of water to food. The next is about color and flavor. So blanching brightens the color of some foods by removing air and dust on the surface and thus altering the wavelength of reflected light. So the time and temperature of blanching also influence the change in food pigments when we are comparing it to that of D value. So sodium carbonate or calcium oxide are often added to Blancher water to protect chlorophyll and to retain the color of green vegetables. Although the increasing pH may increase the loss of ascorbic acid. So changes in color and flavor could also be observed. Then coming to the texture, one of the purposes of blanching is to soften the texture of vegetables to facilitate filling into containers prior to canning. So however, when used for freezing or drying, the time temperature conditions needed to achieve enzyme inactivation, they cause an excessive loss of texture in some type of food. For example, certain varieties of potatoes and in large pieces of food. And calcium chloride is therefore added to blancher water to form insoluble flash calcium pectate complexes and thus to maintain firmness in the tissues. So that's all about blanching. Thank you.